The Lord be with you.
And also
with you. Great to see everybody here this morning, especially with school starting back up for some people, and that gets to be a very busy time of year. But speaking of that, next week we have Rally Day, and we'll install our preschool teachers and Bible study leaders and all that good stuff. So getting to be an exciting time around here. And I'm glad to see that we have quite the throng to go through it together. I stole that from our opening hymn, which I invite you to stand for at this time. Rejoice, O pilgrim throng. God bless your worship. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
The eyes of the Lord are toward the righteous.
And his ears toward
when the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears.
And he
the Lord is near to the brokenhearted.
And saves
the we pause for a moment of silence to call to mind our own personal sins. Let us confess our sins to God our Father.
Merciful God, we confess that we are, according to our fallen nature, sinners in need of your deliverance. We cannot free ourselves from our slavery to sin, and so we cry to you for forgiveness and release from our troubles and our brokenness. For the sake of your Son, and by his atoning suffering and death on the cross,
at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light. In mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, And for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. May the Lord, who has begun this good work in us, bring it to completion on the day of Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. Please be seated for our hymn of praise. Please rise for prayer. Let us pray. Almighty God, whom to know is everlasting life, grant us to know your Son Jesus, to be the way, the truth, and the life, that we may steadfastly follow his steps in the way that leads to life eternal. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Please be seated for the readings.
Good morning.
Good morning.
The readings on the 13th and this 13th day after Pentecost begin with the Old Testament Proverbs 9, beginning at verse 1. Wisdom has built her house. She has hewn her seven pillars. She has slaughtered her beast. She has mixed her wine. She has also set her table. She has sent out her young women to call from the highest places in the town. Whoever is simple, let him turn in here. To him who lacks sense, she says, come, eat my bread, and drink the wine I have mixed. Leave your simple ways and live, and walk in the way of insight. Whoever corrects a scoffer gets himself abuse, and he who reproves a wicked man incurs injury. Do not reprove a scoffer, or he will hate you. Reprove a right man, and he will love you. Give instruction to a wise man, and he will become still wiser. Teach a righteous man, and he will increase in learning. The fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, and the knowledge of the Holy One is insight. This is the word of the Lord. Our epistle comes from Ephesians chapter 5, beginning at verse 6. Let no one deceive you with empty words, for because of these things the wrath of God comes upon the sons of disobedience. Therefore do not become partners with them. For at one time you were darkness, but now you are light in the Lord. Walk as children of light, for the fruit of the light is found in all that is good and right and true. And try to discern what is pleasing to the Lord. Take no part in the fruitful works of darkness, but instead expose them. For it is shameful even to speak of the things that they do in secret. But when anything is exposed by the light, it becomes visible. For anything that becomes visible is light. Therefore it says, awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time. Because the days are evil, therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery. But be filled with the Spirit, addressing one another in psalms and hymns and spiritual songs, singing and making melody to the Lord with your heart, giving thanks always for everything to God, the Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, submitting to one another out of reverence for Christ. This is the word of our Lord.
Please rise in honor of our risen Lord Jesus for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Jews then disputed among themselves, saying, how can this man give us his flesh to eat? So Jesus said to them, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him. As the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever feeds on me, he also will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not as the fathers ate and died. Whoever feeds on this bread will live forever. Jesus said these things in the synagogue as he taught at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, this is a hard saying. Who can listen to it? But Jesus, knowing in himself that his disciples were grumbling about this, said to them, do you take offense at this? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit who gives life. The flesh is of no avail. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life, but there are some of you who do not believe. For Jesus knew from the beginning who those were who did not believe and who it was who would betray him. And he said, this is why I told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted him by the Father. After this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. So Jesus said to the 12, do you want to go away as well? Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
May be seated for the hymn of the day, and as the children are dismissed for Sunday school.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be to you from God our Father and our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. Dear brothers and sisters in Christ, or should I say, dear fellow cannibals and atheists, I beg your pardon. That sounds a bit shocking on a Sunday morning, doesn't it, at church? But the Christians in the first century, that is our great, 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 you get the idea, ancestors in the faith, going all the way back to the first century, like the one in ancient Rome, the gathering of believers there, or the one in Ephesus that the Apostle Paul had planted, those first century Christians would have grown quite accustomed to hearing the pagans name-calling, Christians are all cannibals and atheists. Why? Why cannibals? Why atheists? That seems really odd to us today, doesn't it? As to allegedly being atheists, well, those first Christians denied the pantheon of gods on Mount Olympus. And that includes false gods like Bacchus, the god of wine, who is in the news routine lately. He's also the god of pleasure, and apparently he's the god to whom post-Christian France today evidently still pays homage, if you happen to catch the Paris Games for that 33 Olympiad. But now as to cannibalism, okay, why would first century pagans call God-fearing Christians cannibals of all things? Well, that one has to do with our gospel lesson this morning from John 6. And our final installment of the Bread of Life discourse that we've been looking at these past 3 weeks. Jesus, where we encounter him today in our reading, has been teaching at great length a persistent portion of the crowd of 5,000 men whom he had previously fed the previous day with just five loaves, of course, five loaves of bread, two fish. It just happened to be what a little convenient child had nearby. And now those well-fed disciples who ate of that bread, they are still hungry and calling upon Jesus to make some more bread. And so they follow him all the way to Capernaum just for this. And perhaps even now, as we see them in our passage, they're starting to get a little bit hangry with Jesus. Well, Jesus, for his part, is not forthcoming with another miraculous mass feeding, but instead was relating to them this wondrous heavenly truth about himself, saying, I am the living bread that came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread that I will give for the life of the world is my flesh. That's verse 51 from our gospel. Well, instead of his hungry audience really hearing him and seeking understanding, they kept trying to press him rather into miraculously manufacturing more wonder bread. These followers were fixated on the bread that perishes. Jesus' offer of so much more to them seemed to continually fall upon deaf ears. So finally, with the harshest and most controversial way yet of putting it to them, Jesus comes out and tells the unruly crowd of disciples, quote, truly, truly, I say to you, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. Verse 53. Well, one might think that just the shock value alone of Jesus' wording there might finally derail their stomach's blind quest for more starch and arrest their attention long enough for them to finally focus on the astounding life-bestowing claims that Jesus was repeatedly making. Now was the time, if ever there was, for them to take to heart that scripture, man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. But instead of hearing that word and recognizing Jesus as the same God from whose mouth those words originally proceeded, way back in Deuteronomy 8:3, these earthly-minded disciples took offense at Jesus' words. And verse 66 says, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. It's at this point in the text where it says, when the 12 This is a test for you. When the 12 saw the large crowd of other disciples leaving, they popped up and ran over to Jesus immediately, insisting that he go after them, saying, "Rabbi, there goes almost all of our power base and financial support. Many of those men would gladly take up arms against Rome just when you give your word. We must negotiate their return and renew their allegiance to our movement." Is that what happened next? That's the test. No, not at all. That might be what we would see maybe here in some mega churches in America, where bigger is always better. Just think, thousands of members in the balance. In the very least, it would be a strong temptation for many of us American churches, especially, to want to go and try to woo them back, even if it meant watering down the truth. God help us all. But no, not Jesus. Jesus loved every last one of those who walked away that day. This is the same Jesus who, as he had already told them, came down from heaven to give his flesh for them, indeed for the life of the entire world. This Jesus not only stood and watched them go, but then he turned also to his own 12 and asked them, "Do you want to go away as well?" 12,000 followers, and that's easily how many Jesus had fed the day before, if you count the women and children, 12,000 down to 12 in one day. That's quite the church shrinkage program, right? We talk about church growth, but as we look at Christ, the head of the church here, should we be prioritizing something else and not making growth and size the number one priority? As we look at Christ, this is the Jesus full of grace and truth that John wrote about in his prologue to his gospel. This Jesus loves everybody, yes, but he is the very embodiment of truth. Later in John's gospel, he'll proclaim, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." And by the way, that's another one of his scandalous claims that even Oprah looks askance at, her head shaking and finger wagging to the narrow-minded and exclusive claims there. Well, we'll get that disapproval, dare I say even persecution in some parts of the world. But try this. Next time someone criticizes you for your narrow-minded position that through Christ alone does one get to heaven, say this: "I wouldn't come up with such a narrow way on my own. I'm just trying to keep an open mind that the only teacher ever to say he would come back from the dead and 3 days later actually pulled it off, that guy deserves a listen to." Try that. Might not get very far. But as you do listen to him, the one who could walk on water, the one who could feed 5,000 with 5 loaves, raise the dead, and rise from the dead himself, what does he have to say? Verse 54. "Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day." Now, I don't want anybody here to walk away, but if we're being truthful, and that certainly is one of our takeaways today, truthfulness, we have to admit that is kind of a hard saying for us as well, isn't it? How could we hold that teaching sacred, gladly hear and learn that, as Luther in the Catechism admonishes true disciples to do? That's their proper posture. Gladly receive it. Well, first of all, I think after spending some time here in John chapter 6 already, you probably have noticed by now where that first century charge of cannibalism against Christians came from. Yes, the genesis was in Jesus' misunderstood words. Remember the number of those who walked away from Jesus that day? Probably in the thousands. They walked away with these hard sayings regarding flesh and blood still ringing in their ears, ringing but with no resolution, just confusion. People talk. I'm sure that's one way the rumors started about Christians and cannibalism. And it probably didn't quash the rumors either that the way that the early church conducted somewhat secretive services in the catacombs during those first few centuries, this probably contributed to the rumors. You see, we still follow the ancient church's two-part order of service to this day, all these many centuries later. And let me explain. If you look in your bulletins there on page 6, you'll see a heading there, and it says, the Word of God. That describes the first part of the Christian worship service, the service of the Word. Now, in ancient times, anyone could be invited or show up on their own to that first part of the public worship service. It included the readings and the preaching of the Word of God mainly. So as you have your bulletins out, now turn to page 9 of your worship bulletin. And what heading do you see there on page 9? The Sacrament of Holy Communion. That's the second half of the ancient two-part order of service. First word, and then sacrament. And it's at this sacramental point in the primitive church that only the baptized believers would go deeper into the catacombs, into a private space that they could close off to outsiders for purposes of security, uninterrupted reverence in the ceremony. And they earnestly desired as well to take seriously the Apostle Paul's warning in 1 Corinthians 11, quote, whoever therefore eats the bread or drinks the cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of concerning the body and blood of the Lord, unquote. Well, Paul goes on to tell the Corinthians there that for this reason, some of you have gotten ill or have even died because you ate and drank judgment upon yourselves instead of by faith receiving the blessing of spiritual health and salvation at the Lord's Supper. An unworthy or unprepared manner of taking the sacrament would include being unbaptized or unrepentant. In other words, to be worthy is to properly see yourself as unworthy and in dire need of Christ's atoning sacrifice as the Lamb of God who takes away your sin. Back in the ancient church, the fact that all this kind of exclusive participation in the sacrament went on behind closed doors, see, this only fueled the rumors of cannibalism because it was the uninitiated, the uninstructed ones who were left on the outside to speculate what's going on in there. And when they heard Christ himself quoted as saying, unless you eat the flesh of the Son of Man and drink his blood, you have no life in you. So you can't totally blame a person who's uninitiated for allowing his mind to kind of imagine things and then go and spread half-truths that inevitably get blown out of proportion. And the next thing you know, Christians are cannibals and atheists. That's where it goes. Despite the fact that some of the outsiders trying to look in on the ancient Christians could have just been honestly confused about their communion practices, we know that the allegations are completely misplaced, and we can, these many centuries removed, kind of laugh about them now. But there's certainly much more going on in this passage concerning the bread of life than its role confusing some first century Romans. One frequent question about John 6 that's very important to mention, especially on this Communion Sunday, is this. Is this passage in John 6 even talking about communion? Does Jesus have the Lord's Supper in view here behind all his talk about eating flesh and drinking blood? Well, answers to this question, they cover the whole waterfront with every viewpoint from every denomination chiming in, giving their own interpretation, to which I suppose they're all entitled. And it can begin to get a little heated in the exchange once you start comparing notes. Even within our own Lutheran tradition, there are different schools of thought that have sprung up, some saying, no, John 6 is not about communion. Some saying, yes, it is. But most recently, it does seem as though a growing consensus within our Lutheran ranks has been substantially achieved. Not 100%, but getting there. And what's their view on it today? Kind of a both and. Yes, you can see John hinting at some truths about the Lord's Supper that will come into play down the road once you see the Lord actually give the words of institution. This is my body, this is my blood. That's forthcoming at the Lord's Supper, but you won't find it here in John's Gospel, as John does not record the supper, but you get it in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and then in Corinthians that we read from. And as Lutherans, we want to talk about the sacramental union, we call it, sacramental union of the bread and the wine with the body and the blood. We do receive the true body and blood, but it remains a mystery as to how the Lord pulls this off. Maybe that's why we call it a sacrament. If you take the Greek equivalent of that Latin term sacrament, it's mysterion, from which we get our English word mystery. So we don't try to explain how the Lord pulls this off. After all, he is the Lord, and he himself says, with the bread, we receive his body, and with the cup, we receive his shed blood. So faith trusts in the risen Lord who teaches us these things. It's that simple for us Lutherans. So you can see from John 6, some truths do seem to come to bear on the supper that we share together, but everything in John 6 is not necessarily meant to be directly imported into our celebration of the Lord's Supper. As well, John's Bread of Life discourse, of course, has its own unique truth revealed in it that are just tied to its own historical setting, as so many other remarkable events in our Lord's earthly ministry have as well. One fine gem that emerges from John 6 that does show up at the altar and really is meant to be taken everywhere you go under heaven, especially to the altar rail, and that gem is faith. We see this play out right at the end of our John 6 reading. The bread brigade, all those hungry disciples, we find they're still bound in their thinking to earthly things, just like Esau famously sold his intangible birthright for a very tangible and tasty bowl of soup. Jesus at this point basically pushes this bread brigade over the edge now when he says, quote, it's the spirit who gives life. The flesh is no help at all. It avails nothing. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and they are life. Well, that was enough intangible spirit talk for them. They saw no bread delivery truck coming their direction and they said, we're going. And they never looked back. And it's at this point that Jesus turns to his 12 now and asks the follow-up question for them. Do you want to go away as well? Now this time, Peter is spot on, and you can't always say that's the case with Peter. Lord, he says, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life, and we have believed and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. Well, you know Peter got that right, because we just sang his enduring words right before our gospel readings, right? We sang what he just quoted. All these centuries later, we're still singing it, and the whole liturgical church on earth is also singing those same words. And Peter gets it right there on two counts. Number one, he says, we have believed. That's faith, right? Belief. But it's not just generic belief, as in one belief is as good as any other belief. No. Faith is only as good as the object in which you place it. And Peter was very specific. Lord, he said, to whom shall we go? You, Lord, you have the words of eternal life. Peter got that right. That's the best place in the universe to put your faith, in the Lord Jesus Christ himself and in him alone. He's all you need. Even as Jesus himself said over and over again in John 6, if anyone eats this bread, he will live forever. So now he invites you to take your portable faith with you once again up to the communion table. His invitation, come, eat of my bread and drink of the wine I have mixed. That's his simple invitation to you today. And here at the altar, you both exercise your faith and feed your faith. Luther says in the sacrament, you're to believe every word that proceeds from the mouth of Christ, who is God. For if you let doubt creep in at any one point, well, he said it's his body, but is it really? Well, if you do that, then you fall prey to doubting whether your sins are truly forgiven or if you have been actually given the gift of life. Unbelief has therefore robbed your sins of being truly forgiven. It has robbed you of also the strengthening of your faith that communion is designed to provide you. But when you trust in your good shepherd who laid down his life for you, shed his innocent blood for you, then your troubled conscience is troubled no more, knowing you have received exactly what is told you, the full forgiveness of all your sins. That is the promise of the Son, fulfilling the will of the Father and sealing you forever in the power of the Holy Spirit. Amen. And now may he who began this good work bring it to completion on the day of Christ Jesus. Amen. And speaking of historic faith, we have an opportunity to rise and confess it together as one church family on page 8 of your bulletin. Please rise as we make confession of our faith using the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God, begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, who for us men, for our salvation, came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us, suffered and was buried. On the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will have no end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins. And I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
You may be seated as we continue our worship with the offering.
Please join me as we join our hearts in prayer. Let us pray for the whole Church of God in Christ Jesus and for all people according to their needs. Father, we thank you that you've sent the great Good Shepherd who has compassion on his flock. In his name, we lift up our prayers for the family of God, for every nation, tribe, people, and language, and for all those who hunger for the true bread of life. Lord, in your mercy. Grant us always, O God, to work for the food that endures to eternal life. Bless the ministry of this congregation. Guide us in our call process and future plans and our outreach to our community and to those who don't yet know that God became flesh to redeem all sinners, that they may embrace Jesus and believe that he is the true bread from heaven. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, our God, we pray for your blessing upon all homes and schools as they start back up, especially the schools, universities, and seminaries of our church. Bless all places where your people gather to teach and learn your word, and help us to remember that the fear of the Lord is the beginning of all wisdom. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, you place men in positions of authority for the sake of order. Grant wisdom to our national, state, and local leaders. Keep our military personnel safe as they seek to achieve peace in a war-torn world. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, bestow your power of healing upon the sick and those whom we name in the privacy of our own hearts at this time. Lord, according to your will, answer their prayers that we might give thanks to your name and glorify you for your work among us. Give your spirit of hope as well to those who mourn, especially those in Eliezer Kosi's family. Strengthen their faith and assure them of your presence in all circumstances. Lord, in your mercy. Holy Father, your Son assures us that his flesh is true food and his blood true drink, and that those who feed on him will live forever because of him. By your Spirit, then, prepare our hearts to welcome him as he comes to us in the Holy Supper, that we may rejoice in his promises and depart in his peace. Lord, in your mercy. O Lord, Heavenly Father, we gratefully remember the sufferings and death of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, for our salvation. Rejoicing in his victorious resurrection from the dead, we draw strength from his ascension before you, where he ever stands for us as our own high priest. Gather us together from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive all our prayers, deliver and preserve us, for to you alone we give all glory, honor, and worship, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on this day overcame death in the grave and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name evermore, praising you and singing. Remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Our Lord Jesus, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread, and when he blessed it, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And then in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had blessed it, he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Drink of it, all of you. This cup is the new covenant, my blood, which is shed for the remission of all your sins. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." The peace of the Lord be with you always. Take and eat the true body of our Lord Jesus Christ, given unto death. Please rise for the post-communion canticle. For the miracle and gift of faith in our hearts.
We praise you,
for your very body and blood given to us in grace.
We praise you,
for the comfort of your peace in all our afflictions.
We praise you,
now receive the blessing of the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine on you and be gracious to you. The Lord look upon you with favor and grant you his everlasting peace. May be seated for our closing hymn, Sent Forth by God's Blessing.
Thank you.
very nice. Nice organ playing day, Sandy. I love that thing. So it works out really nice. If you're a visitor, special welcome to you. You're invited to join us down the steps for some coffee and some cookies or what have you, what kind of sweets are there. I mentioned next week is Rally Sunday. So if you're a Sunday school teacher, or preschool teacher, anything like that, we'd love for you to come. We're going to bring you up and install you for another year. That'll be very nice. And it's also going to entail having some hot dogs, a bounce house, all sorts of stuff going on after the service. So same time as usual, 10 o'clock. Diana?
All of our name tags, well, I shouldn't say all, everybody who has told me they need a new name tag, it has been ordered, and I should be getting them next week, and hopefully they'll be in your mailbox for next Sunday. If anybody here does not have a name tag, I can still add to the list. Please see me after the service. Thank you.
David, yeah, come on up. We missed you last week.
Yeah, I was in Las Vegas. Sunshine's aunt and uncle got married short notice to us, not short notice to them. And so I figured it'd be easier to stay with a sister congregation than it would be to leave at 4 in the morning to get back here.
I hear that.
Issues, et cetera, they did have their Making the Case conference. Now it is available digitally, both as like a podcast and a video. If you guys were interested, you go to issuesetc.org. And before Labor Day, I think it's a $300 tax-deductible donation to them. But they have a whole bunch of great speakers like Pastor Chris Roseborough, Riley Gaines, the swimmer, and then also the most probably, I don't know, endearing thing is Pastor Will Whedon's hymn sing. So it's probably cheaper, $300, than airfare, room and board, ticket to go to Chicago for us. Maybe if you lived in the Midwest, maybe not, but it'd be a valuable thing to look into, maybe.
One of these days, you and I are going to go. I don't know when.
Next year.
Also, Kevin's got his Bible class afterwards in the coffee house, Proverbs Coffee House. Get some coffee, bring it in the house, and get in some lovable theology. That'll be great. Anything else that needs to be announced? Any birthdays? Fess up. All right. Have a great week. God bless. The Lord goes with you.